Good morning and welcome to the 9th meeting of the Public Audit and Post-Legislative Scrutiny Committee. Can I ask that everyone present switch off their electronic devices or switch them to silent mode so that they do not affect the work of the committee this morning? I'd also like to say that we're missing a couple of members and a witness from the first panel due to terrible weather conditions and train delays coming from the west, but we're going to proceed, but the MSPs who are not here may join us throughout the course of proceedings. Item 1, the committee is invited to agree to take items 4, 5 and 6 in private. Item 4 is consideration of evidence received under item 2 on the audit of Scotland's colleges 2016. Item 5 is consideration of evidence received under item 3 on the 14-15 audit of Edinburgh College. And item 6 is for the committee to consider its work programme. Do members agree to take these items in private? Thank you. Item 2 is an evidence session on the Auditor General for Scotland's report entitled Scotland's Colleges 2016. I welcome to the meeting Paul Johnson, Director General for Learning and Justice, and Dr. John Kemp, Interim Chief Executive of the Scottish Funding Council. Good morning to you both. I invite Paul Johnson to make a brief opening statement, followed by Dr. Kemp, before I open up to questions from members.
Thank you, Convener, and I appreciate the opportunity to provide evidence today in response to the Auditor-General's report on Scotland's colleges. As Director-General for Learning and Justice, I am the accountable officer for the Education and Skills portfolio. So I have responsibility for ensuring that the Funding Council's strategic direction aligns with the priorities of the Scottish Government and that it has the necessary controls in place to safeguard public funds. The accountable officer for the Funding Council is Dr. Kemp, and the Funding Council is accountable for the delivery of the Scottish Government's policy objectives and for the deployment of resources to deliver those objectives. The Scottish Government accepts the recommendations in today's report that are for the Scottish Government to implement, and we will be working with the Funding Council to ensure that the recommendations are implemented. We will be seeking to ensure that we learn lessons from the matters that are raised in the report and apply them both to our work on colleges and to other areas of public service reform. Since the Auditor-General's report, progress has been made on a number of the recommendations, in particular through the publication of the document Impact and Success of the Programme of College Mergers in Scotland, a Funding Council document that I'm sure we'll have the opportunity to discuss. I welcome the fact that this document now sets out further detail about the annual savings that college reform is achieving. It also confirms that the programme of reform has created colleges which are more resilient and sustainable, better suited to the delivery of skills, better suited to engagement with employers and universities, and better able to improve the provision for learners. I'm not surprised by that, because in preparing for today, I looked again at Sir Ian Wood's conclusions in his report on developing Scotland's young workforce. Even in 2014, he found that the colleges he had engaged with had been re-energised and were reinventing themselves as larger units with a regional status and greater potential to develop and influence. And you've already seen, certainly in my written submission, some of the evidence, some of the figures that we have, which demonstrate some of the success that we can point to in terms of those newly reinvigorated colleges. Moving forward, we recognise that colleges are still adjusting to substantial changes, and we will use the findings of the Auditor General's report to secure further progress. Good governance is, of course, crucial, and I welcome the fact that the Auditor General recognises the likely positive impact of implementing the Good Governance Task Group's recommendations. The Enterprise and Skills Review also allows us to ensure that the functions of the Scottish Funding Council are clearly defined and with a focus on securing continued improvements in both the college and university sector. And I look forward to discussing these matters further.
Thank you very much, Mr. Johnson. Dr. Kemp.
Thank you again for this opportunity to discuss the Auditor General's report. The report covers the latter period of a period of great change in the college sector in Scotland, as well as the merger programme. There was the related regionalisation of funding, including the introduction of outcome agreements, a revised funding method, the inclusion of colleges into public sector accounting, and the introduction of national bargaining. As the Auditor General's report makes clear, the sector has continued to meet activity targets and maintain financial stability through this period. In the summary of the post-merger evaluations that we published in August this year, we concluded that they had largely been a success and had created colleges that are better suited to respond to the needs of their regions and interact with local authorities and universities. This success has been a tribute to the staff and the colleges who have implemented the mergers. We recognise also there have been challenges. There has been a drop in the success rate for full-time FE courses in some colleges. There were a small number of very significant governance difficulties, which this committee's predecessors have examined. As you will have seen from my organisation's letter to the committee of the 29th September, we've accepted the recommendations of the Auditor General's report. In some cases, we've already substantially addressed some of the recommendations, such as those on the cost of mergers and on the publication of leaver destinations. We will continue to work with the college sector and with the government to address the other recommendations. And I'm very happy to answer your questions on how we'll do so.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kemp. Alex Neil.
Can I start with a kind of very general question? And I recognise, obviously, that some of this predates particularly your appointment, Dr. Kemp. But obviously, if you look at the reports from the Auditor General, I think the first conclusion you would reach is this is not how to go about a major reform programme. There's a lack of baseline information against which future progress can be measured. There was a lack of comprehensive financial planning. Probably one of the single biggest costs is going to be obviously the harmonisation of pay rates across the college sector. That wasn't included in the original costs. We've had the decline in the attainment rate, and at the end of the day, this is primarily about attainment. There was no proper equality impact assessment done. We still don't know what impact the changes have had on inclusiveness and the equality. We've seen some of the governance issues. I think there's a question mark over the added value and competence of the funding council itself. We now have a situation where we've got a funding council looking at a much smaller number of colleges across Scotland, but we've also put a layer of regional management between the national management and the local management. I'm not clear what added value that brings to the table. I mean, it really has been a bit of a fiasco, hasn't it?
That's a very big question. But in response to that, you know, that last point, has it been a fiasco? No, it has not. I think there are aspects, as I've said in my opening statement, of the merger process that could have been done better. But by and large, I think this merger programme has been a success. It was implemented fairly quickly and I think fairly effectively by the colleges involved. There were governance issues in some areas, I accept that. And the Auditor General has pointed out that, you know, there were some things it might have been better to have baselines on. But by and large, the mergers were set out to achieve a purpose, which were to create large regional colleges which could interact with the employers, the local authorities, the universities in their region far better than the colleges we had before, and I think that has been achieved. And that was something we were clear about at the outset, and you know, that has been achieved. I accept the point that some things could have been done better, but by and large, this has been, I think, a good process. Now, some of the other things you talk about there that were going on at the same time, which were not part of the merger process, have made it more complex. National bargaining is something that, you know, we do not know the full costs of yet. It's a process that is still being going through. But College Scotland has been supported through the Employers Association, you know, to help ensure that that is done, you know, effectively and efficiently. But yes, it is an unknown. I suspect that if we were to wait until all of the unknowns about all the other things that were happening in the sector at the time were out of the way to do a merger process when there were no other complications, we'd end up never doing it, and we'd have lost the benefits of creating these bigger, more effective colleges. You're right, in some areas there is another layer between the funding council and the colleges. I would stress that is very much the minority of areas. The legislation created the opportunity for some regions to have a regional board, but only where the colleges didn't choose to merge to form one regional college. And actually, and of the 13 regions, 10 of them are single college regions. They merged to form one regional college. The three exceptions, are with the exception of Lanarkshire, which could have gone either way. Glasgow is a very big city, with 20% of the college provision. The idea of one college there was one there that wasn't going to happen immediately. So a regional board there, was the outcome. In the Highlands, you're dealing with a very disparate area, and there is a different layer. In the UHI as the regional board. But I would contend that in those areas, we wanted to fund, and the legislation allowed for, to fund a region rather than individual colleges. Those regional bodies, which some of which are fully operational, some of which aren't yet, will bring together the region so that the region has one voice and there is coherence from within the region on how you allocate money to the colleges. And I think that is a value that wasn't there before. So I accept there was a lot of complexities about the merger process. I don't accept it was a fiasco.
Could I follow up on that as well? I would also not accept that this is a merger that should be seen as a fiasco, to use that language. Indeed, I think there are many, many aspects of the merger process that have been successful. And we've got a lot of figures, some of which were set out in the written note that I provided to the committee, which I think point to that success. Now, there was a lot in the question which we may perhaps develop further in the course of the session, but I would pick up at this stage on the point about baseline data. In particular, I think we should be very clear that there was and is a significant amount of baseline data that we can point to that shows an improving trend from both before, during and after the merger process. So if, for example, we look at the number of full-time students, the increase in numbers, if we look at the overall trend in relation to attainment, we see real increases. Now, I absolutely accept that in some areas there was not baseline data, areas such as college destinations, and that data is now being gathered. I would contend that the college merger process, with a smaller number of larger and more strategic bodies, actually enables us to now gather a much richer picture of data around the performance of the sector as a whole, and enables us to build on and really drive improvement through having that richer picture.
You both started off by saying it's been a success. Now, the measure of success for somebody like me is the improvement in attainment, the improvement in the chances, educational chances of people at the lower end of the income scale. Obviously, destinations is an important measure as well. Now, if we look at attainment, attainment's actually down. The dropout rate still is quite significant. The improvement in the ability of people of low income, and I recognise the college sector historically has been far better at achieving that than the university sector, but still, where is the evidence of linking any improvement that there has been that you've referred to this process? Is this not improvement that might have taken place anyway in many of these areas? Where is the added value of the merger process and the reorganisation and the other reforms that you've mentioned? And that's where I don't think it's convincing that these improvements, where there have been improvements, have been the result of this process.
post-merger evaluations that we did with each of the colleges, we spoke to the colleges, to other stakeholders and so on, about how they interacted with the college. And I think there's a lot of evidence in that report of how, you know, the mergers have affected how colleges can interact with universities on articulation and so on. And that's, you know, fairly clearly attributable to the mergers. There are
an outcome of things like achievement, you know, like attainment.
The improvements that have been happening in things like the numbers of people articulating from college to university, I think that is part of what is leading to that. On the issue of
Where's the proof? I mean, you're saying you think it is, but where is the proof? Your evidence you've just said that is because of this process. Where is your evidence? If you've got the evidence, fine, but I so far have not seen the evidence due to this process.
I would contend that we've published a lot of the evidence that leads us to conclude that in the post-merger evaluations and in the summary of the post-merger evaluations. To turn to your point on attainment has been on an upwards trend. There has been in FE full-time success rates, a drop of 2%. That was not entirely in the merging colleges. Some of the colleges that dropped were merging colleges. Some of the colleges that dropped were not merging colleges. Some of the merging colleges continued the upward trend. So I don't think...
Then there is no correlation.
Well, it is my point that the correlation between the mergers and the drop in attainment, I think, is not made, because there was... That happened in some of the colleges that merged and some didn't. Now, we did look at the detail, you know, with the colleges of what led to that drop in FE. I mean, it's worth stressing that HE didn't drop. It only went down by 0.1. It was broadly flat. And there were a variety of reasons. In some cases, it was, they said, related to systems issues related to the mergers. But in the vast majority, it was other issues related to concerns about bursaries. It was, in one case, you know, since sustained period of strikes and so on. So there was no one single reason. There was a variety of reasons, and you know, we've been working with the colleges through the outcome agreements to make sure that those reasons don't reoccur, and the colleges are confident that they are on track, you know, to resume the upward trend in success rates in colleges. So I think, you know, to say that is in any way a consequence of the merger programme, I don't think the link is there.
Well, I mean, that's, I think, an open question, given the evidence that we've seen, very much so. But, I mean, obviously, we need to look to the future and learn the lessons. And to be fair, you have said that you will learn the lessons and you'll implement the Auditor General's recommendations. Can I ask a sort of wider question? Because, obviously, there is this proposal, and where I'm coming from is where... What is the role of the Funding Council? What's the level of competence in the Funding Council? What's the added value of the Funding Council? And obviously, there's a proposal on the table that the Funding Council will become part of a broader organisation incorporating Scottish Enterprise, Highlands and Islands Enterprise and the Scottish Funding Council. How do you think that is going to impact on the role and the function and the efficiency of the Scottish Funding Council? Where are the benefits of that proposed reorganisation?
Perhaps pick up the point about the Enterprise and Skills Review broadly and then hand over to John for any specific comment about the Funding Council. So we have now completed phase one of the Enterprise and Skills Review, as the committee will probably be aware. And the conclusion of that emphasises the need for close strategic alignment in terms of the Funding Council, Skills Development Scotland, Scottish Enterprise and Highlands and Islands Enterprise, and does recognise the fact that that cannot be delivered without us looking very carefully at the overarching governance arrangements that exist. However, we're now looking in detail at the implementation of the overarching recommendations. That is phase two of the Enterprise and Skills Review. That has not been concluded, and it's as part of phase two that we will be looking carefully at the role of the Scottish Funding Council. We'll be reflecting on the Auditor General's recommendations in her report report about the role of the Scottish Funding Council as regards colleges, and we'll be reporting on that in due course.
Can I ask who we is?
Well, when I'm referring to we, I'm referring to the Scottish Government. It is a review that is being led by government ministers, and I and other civil servants are, of course, supporting ministers in that work.
And are there any external independent people involved in that review?
Yes, we have been working very closely with a panel that includes a wide range of external participants. I can provide the committee with full details of the membership of that panel, but it certainly includes, for example, representatives from the college and university sector.
Okay. That's all I have just now.
Thank you.
I might come back.
Okay. Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Mayor. I'm looking at submission by Colleges Scotland, and there's a lot of very positive stuff in there. For example, the 10% increase in attainment and the 5% increase in retention over the last 6 years. But there's one thing sort of stares at me here, which is something that was actually discussed at yesterday's Education Committee, which is about depreciation. And I think it might be, this is on page 2 under reclassification paragraph, second paragraph on that. It might be helpful for this committee if the same document which SFC circulated as a result of Liz Smith and my own visit to the Queen Margaret University, if that could be circulated, which well explains the depreciation process.
We'd be very happy to do that. That's not a problem.
Now, it's highlighted here again that the issue about depreciation causes technical deficits at the colleges, which makes it very difficult, for example, for the audit committee to look at the colleges and say whether they're in good financial health, because the bottom line looks as if it's a problem. How are we going to address that in the future?
As the Auditor General suggests in the reports, it needs to be clearer in the annual accounts of the colleges, and our guidance to the colleges on their annual accounts has asked them to make that far clearer in their published accounts, so that it is quite clear when a deficit is a technical deficit caused by the spending of the depreciation cash, and when it is, you know, an underlying real deficit. So that is something that we have put in guidance to the colleges relatively recently, and in future accounts that should be far clearer than it has been in the past.
Is my memory correct that this is about £29 million in that region?
It's a bit less than that, yeah. From my memory, it's just under 20. Yeah.
Just under 20.
It's in that region.
College of Scotland are asking for the colleges to have flexibility in using the money arising from this and not having to seek prior permission from the Scottish Government, presumably every year. Is there any prospects of that changing?
So we recognise that there is an issue around the use of the depreciation cash, and what I cannot give a definitive answer today to the committee, because discussions are still ongoing, but I know that those with expertise in this area have been meeting, and that includes officials from the Scottish Government, colleagues in the Funding Council and in Colleges Scotland, actively working through this issue. It is a relatively new issue brought about through reclassification, and it is one which we recognise requires to be resolved. And what I can say is that we will absolutely keep this committee updated with the progress of those discussions. I particularly take the point around the need for colleges pardon me, to have certainty as to the use that they can make of the totality of their resource, and to have certainty at the outset of the financial year, or indeed in advance of the financial year, wherever possible. That's what we're working together to seek to achieve.
My understanding that this treatment of depreciation is in terms of current accounting principles, but I also understand that the college sector accounting is different from the rest of the public sector, which makes it difficult perhaps to draw comparisons. Would that be correct?
Yesterday, when you asked that question, I had the benefit of my Director of Finance next to me, and who explained that different parts of the public sector have different statements of recommended practice for accounting. So yes, there are different ways that accounts are done in different parts of the public sector, and that colleges and universities operate in a particular way, and that's what causes this issue. Yes, you're correct.
Just moving on, I'm looking at another submission by EIS here, and I'm looking at pages 1 and 2, starting with paragraph 4. They seem to be questioning the accuracy of SFC reporting, and indeed they talk about the SFC reports on college mergers being excessively rosy and contrasting unfavourably with Audit Scotland's overview. What would be your thoughts on that criticism?
We have discussed with the EIS the issue of their view of mergers being different from ours. And when we were doing the post-merger evaluations, we were very careful to speak to groups of staff across the various campuses of merging colleges. And we also, on many occasions, spoke to groups organised by the EIS. And I think it's fair to say there was sometimes a difference in the views between those groups of staff that had been organised by us and ones organised by the EIS. And that is a real issue. But I don't think we have been excessively rosy in the reports. If you read some of the reports, what we have said is by and large the mergers have worked, but that has not been the case in every single case. In the case of Edinburgh College, which we were discussing later, we went and did a third post-merger evaluation, and that third post-merger evaluation is still indicating there are significant problems. So where there have been very significant problems, I think we have reported that in the post-merger evaluations. But I would accept that, and we have discussed it with the EIS, there have been differences of view on how they've felt things have gone and how well we've felt. But we've based it often on what we've heard from staff in the colleges. So it's always difficult to get the right balance there.
Sticking to that theme, I'm looking at Unison's evidence on page 2 under further education. I think it's really the second paragraph. It says, currently we're in a position where the government and SFC claim not to have responsibility / powers over how colleges are run. Can you...
Well, we don't run colleges. The colleges are run by their boards and by their principals. However, we do have responsibilities. Myself, as accountable officer for the funding that's spent, that goes into colleges, for how that money is spent, and we have a series of responsibilities relating to governance and how programmes are taken forward. But where there is often an imbalance is an expectation that everything in a college, can be resolved by government or funding council. And there are some things that are the responsibility of the principal and the board. There are some things where if things are going way off track, then it is the responsibility of the funding council or the government. But it's been clear about what these are.
Could I add something to that, please? I would suggest that, as in any system, there's a balance of roles, responsibility and accountability in the system. And I think it's very clear that the Scottish Government has certain responsibilities in relation to colleges. And in particular, Scottish Government will set the strategic direction and will task the Funding Council with the delivery of the overarching strategic objectives of government. I think it's also important to note that alongside the process of college mergers, what we've seen is a strengthening of the outcome agreement framework that exists between the Funding Council and the regional colleges. And I think that's a really crucial way in which both government, through government's overall strategy and through the detail of the outcome agreements, there can be clarity as to the expectations that exist of colleges, and also a very clear reporting mechanism as to the outcomes that are actually being delivered by individual colleges.
Still sticking with the Unison report, they're also saying here that the SFC does not appear to feel it should look at how colleges are spending money other than round issues like gross misconduct and fraud. And in the same light, they're saying the role of the SFC in monitoring and engagement has not improved. So they're fairly critical.
Yes, that is what they say. I would superintendent, we are interested in how colleges spend money, not just in areas where it's gross misconduct, because it's public money and we have a fairly extensive system through the outcome agreements of ensuring that that is spent on the right thing and is achieving the aims for which it was intended. So I'm not quite sure what they mean by us only being interested where it's gross misconduct or fraud. We quite often claw back money that it's not achieving the ends that we want, because and there's no hint of gross misconduct or fraud. It's just not achieving the ends we want. We're happy to engage further with Unison to find out whether that can be taken further. But again, I would stress that colleges are run by their boards and their principals. Our job is to fund them and support them to achieve the aims of the funding council, the government, the wider parliament. Our job is not to micromanage colleges, and we need to get that balance.
Perhaps referring to the regulatory role that SFC has as well, which doesn't seem that well defined at this point.
We'll take it up with Unison to see exactly what they meant. It could also be an intervention in pay and so on. There are periodic calls for us to be more involved in that.
Well, I might add that we have recently had the College Good Governance Task Group, which seeks to ensure that there is clarity over the governance role that SFC plays, and indeed it was helpful to see that the Auditor General's view was that the recommendations of that Good Governance Task Group were likely to improve the overall governance arrangements and clarify the role of the Funding Council in these important governance issues. And I know that that task group is meeting again to ensure that the recommendations that have been made are indeed on track.
Liam Kerr.
Thank you. Morning. So I'm just looking at page 11 of this report. The Scottish Government expected college mergers to lead to a number of benefits. And last year, the Auditor General reported that the Scottish Government and SFC had not specified how they would measure the expected benefits of the mergers, and have still not publicly set out when the benefits will be achieved and how they'll be measured. So, how will the benefits be measured or demonstrated, and when will we know about that?
I think that things have already moved on since the Auditor General reported. As I said, I accept the recommendations in her report, and I think what's a particularly important document is this one, Impact and Success of the Programme of College Mergers in Scotland, published by the Funding Council. This document sets out the range of evidence, and I would emphasise there is a lot of detailed evidence in the report drawn from individual post-merger evaluations. That individual material has now been brought together in this single document with evidence as to the progress that merger has secured, also with information as to the details of the costs and savings.
Okay, but you mentioned earlier that there was an absence of baseline data in some areas. So given that, is it impossible to measure certain of the outcomes?
Yes. So I acknowledge that, well, what I sought to emphasise earlier is that we do have baseline data in quite a number of areas, and we're able to chart the year-on-year progress that colleges have made. I would acknowledge that in two particular areas, positive destinations and student satisfaction, there was not consistent Scotland-wide baseline data when we embarked upon the reform process. But I think there's an interesting issue as to whether reform should have been delayed in order to gather that data. I would argue not. I think the Scottish Government documentation that set out the case for reform set out the really quite urgent need to undertake college reform in order to secure the greater prevalence of colleges of scale. And what is now happening, thanks to the presence of those colleges of scale, is that we are better able to gather a rich picture of data and ensure that future policy decisions are absolutely informed by that data.
Over the page, going backwards at page 9, and this is one of the outcomes that I want to explore, it was estimated that the sector will deliver efficiency savings of 50 million from reform by 2015-16. The SFC responded in January 2016 that it's on track, the sector is on track to achieve those savings. How can you be so sure?
Post-merger evaluations identified savings of around 52 million from nine of the mergers. We excluded one College Edinburgh from that because it was in a deficit position. And I think, as is referred to elsewhere in the report, there is some criticism that we hadn't included the full cost of the harmonisation of the pay of the staff and the colleges. Since the publication of that, we do now have that figure, 6.2 million of recurrent cost relating to harmonisation, which I would stress is probably largely attributable to merger, but may not exclusively be attributable to merger, because national bargaining is a process that had been happening throughout this period or moving towards it. And it's possible that some of the decisions made on how to harmonise had an eye on national bargaining as well as on the merger process. But if you take the 52 million and which are recurrent savings, and then net off that 6.2 million, it takes you to a figure beneath 50 million, at 46 million.
Right. I might come back to that in a second, if you don't mind. I just want to move on, if I may, to page 17. I'm concerned about part-time courses and female participation in particular. So page 17 is the start of a section about the students and staff. And there's a suggestion that as a result of a funding change in 2009, which resulted from a Scottish Government intervention at the time, there's been a steep decline in part-time courses, which has had a disproportionate negative effect on female students in particular, but also older students. Are you able to just give me your thoughts on that?
Start by saying something about that from the government perspective, and you're right to identify the fact that there were deliberate policy decisions made in 2009 and subsequently to put a increased emphasis on the provision of full-time courses and courses that would lead to recognised qualifications. And I should emphasise that second part. It's not the case that there are no part-time courses. Far from it. There are a great deal of part-time education is carried out, but the focus has been on courses that lead to recognised qualifications. Looking overall at this point in time, the figures that I have seen point to around 52% of all college learners being female. I recognise the figures that the Auditor General has set around where the drops have occurred in part-time learning, and I think there are some important points made by the Auditor General around getting an overall picture of the demand that actually exists for college places in Scotland at present. Again, I think reform and a smaller number of colleges enables us to do work on what that overarching picture of demand looks like, and that is work that we are taking forward with the Funding Council and Colleges Scotland.
It's important to preface any discussion of this by recognising that there are still a very substantial number of part-time learners in the college sector, particularly at FE level. The drop in part-time enrolments was a very deliberate decision by the Funding Council and the Government in 2009 in order to prioritise activity on full-time courses for young people at a time of a fairly severe economic downturn. The courses that were squeezed out then tended to be very short courses, often less than 10 hours and often not leading to a recognised qualification. So there has been a squeezing out of that kind of course, and that has accounted for the vast majority of the drop. However, that has not squeezed out part-time entirely. It's still probably the majority of activity at the majority of enrolments at at FE level are part-time, less so at HE level, where it tends to be more full-time. But there is still quite a lot of part-time in the sector. The change That seems to have flattened out. In the last two or three years, the balance between full-time and part-time has remained broadly static. It's not changed much at all. But as Paul said, we do need to work with the colleges to understand whether the current balance is right. Are there groups that are not getting the provision they need? But we are fairly confident that most of what happened in 2009 was to squeeze out very short courses that didn't have the vocational worth of the ones that we replaced them with.
Just a quick historical point, though. Was an equality impact assessment done at the time?
In 2009, we did not do an equality impact assessment, and we should have.
Right. So what learning outcome has come from that? I mean, that's someone's dropped the ball quite significantly there, haven't they?
The learning outcome that came from that is in 2011, when putting learners at the centre was being implemented, we did do an equality outcome assessment, and we do routinely do them now. But we recognise in 2009 we did not do anything that could be... We did look at the impact, but we did not do anything that could be properly described as an equality impact assessment.
And just finally, I'm grateful to my colleague Gail Ross on this, but you talk about restructuring the courses to promote courses that have vocational outcomes and are more likely to lead to employment. From the report, it would appear that there is a reducing percentage of leavers going into employment. And does that suggest that policy has not been successful?
The college leaver destinations are quite complex in that in a university, somebody goes in and comes out 4 years later, and then they either go into further levels of education or they go into work. With colleges, people tend to go in to college and do a one-year course and then perhaps another one-year course that leads to a different qualification. And actually, you're right, the proportion leaving college and going to work has dropped slightly. But the positive destinations, including both work and further levels of study, has gone up.
Could I also just add that we do only have, I think it's fair to say, 2 years of data on this. So I think it would be, I don't think we should assume that there's necessarily a trend based on 2 years, but it's an important issue, and it's one that we do need to look at very carefully. The figures I've got from the most recent publication is that overall, the figures for positive destinations increased last year compared to the year before. But what we saw was a move towards more going on to some form of further education and a slightly smaller number going directly into work. So we've literally just got those two data sets, and we do need to build that up year on year, absolutely ensuring or seeking to ensure that the policy the policy outcome of greater positive destinations for those in college, that those outcomes are secured.
Yeah. Ross.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to direct the committee to my register of interests, which states that I'm a board member of North Highland College. Good morning. There has been a lot covered, and I've had to stroke out question by question as they've been asked as we've gone on. Colin Beattie touched on the finance and deficits, and as we know from the report, eight colleges were forecasting a deficit in 2015-16 and a further 11 in 16-17. And more recent forecasts indicate that 14 colleges now anticipate a deficit in 16-17. Do we have reasons for these forecast deficits? Are there any common themes or patterns emerging? And given reductions in capital funding to the sector, is the current approach to financing estate improvement sustainable?
Some of the deficits that have been forecast at the moment relate to the issue we were discussing earlier with Colin Beattie. They're technical deficits relating to the depreciation cash, and some of them are ones that are related to real deficits. I'm afraid I don't have the figure in front of me for exactly how many are in each category. On estates, that is because of the changes of bringing the colleges into the public sector, the ways that colleges used to finance estates development through building up reserves and borrowing money and then having an element of grant as well sometimes, no longer work. So that's an area where when a college estate now needs to be something that the government and the funding council has far more interest in, because any changes to the estate will essentially need to be financed externally by us. So we are working with the college sector, and this is one of the recommendations in the Auditor General's report, to better understand the estate need. The work we had done previously had not covered the entire estate, because there were much of the estate is quite new. There are a set of modern buildings, and we'd focused on the part that wasn't new. We are now doing a wider estate survey covering the whole of the sector. That will be done. There'll be an initial quick one this year, and then a longer one next year, as we said in the submission to the report. But it is an area where government and the funding council needs to look far more closely at, because colleges, because they're part of the public sector, can't use some of the tools they used to in the past.
I would just add that when we look at some of the figures here, the figures I have for investment in college estates between 2007 and 2015 is a total figure of around £550 million of investment in the estate, and on top of that, an investment of around £300 million through the non-profit distributing model pipeline. And I think we can see, as we look around certain parts of Scotland, some fantastic new college buildings, Glasgow being two clearly being in Glasgow. But I do accept the Auditor General's point about our need to look right across the board at the college estate. And so I welcome the work that is now being undertaken between the Funding Council and Colleges Scotland on that matter. And of course, we in government will be working closely with the Funding Council on the future requirements of the college, but both in terms of capital funding and, of course, revenue funding.
Okay, thank you. You touched on the issue of reserves. So I just want to ask about the arm's length foundations. Some of them hold significant sums of public money. Are they working? Can colleges easily access that money for what they actually need it for? Sometimes it could be for the college estate. And are there any alternatives that might work better?
On the question of whether they're working, the amount of originally there was around 100 million in the ALFs. That has gone down significantly as money has flowed back into the college sector for estates developments and so on. So by and large, I think the answer would be yes, that system is working. Though it's one we need to constantly keep an eye on. The part of the complication is they are arm's length, and while they are set up with the purpose of assisting colleges, there can be other uses of the money too. We will keep a constant eye on that, and if there are other ways of achieving the ends that the ALFs were set up to do by more efficient means, then we would be happy, with the college sector and the government to consider whether, that would be more appropriate. I'm not aware of one at the moment, though.
My understanding is that the Auditor General has confirmed that the arm's length foundations are operating as originally intended, supporting the purposes of each college.
Thank you.
Okay. And can I come in on that point, Mr. Johnson, on capital funding? Because you talked about the 300 million that's going in under a PPP initiative, but I mean, it's slightly disingenuous, isn't it? Because capital funding has decreased by 77% in the college sector since 2012-11. Is this really acceptable?
I acknowledge that there have been significant reductions in the capital funding that has been available to Scottish Government right across the board. And as part of that, it is absolutely the case that colleges have experienced a significant reduction in their core capital funding. However, I do think that the £300 million that has been allocated through the non-profit distributing method is significant. We can see the results of that on the ground in Scotland, but it is something that I would in no means be, by no means would I be complacent about the issue. I absolutely agree that work needs to be done and work is being done to look at the overall condition of the college estate in Scotland to be sure that we can provide for the necessary maintenance and indeed improvements and new builds where that is what is required within the overall difficult financial climate that continues to exist.
Yeah, I'm reassured that you agree that 77 is a significant reduction in funding, but why does the college sector need to take such a huge hit?
Well, I think what's important is that when there's a particular amount of money available for capital funding, consideration is given as to the particular projects that have to have priority at particular points in time, and that will vary. So at certain points in time, there will be very significant investment in some areas, and we only need to look to the likes of the hospital in Glasgow or the bridge, and we can see the amount of capital resource that's going into projects of that nature. But these things will vary from year to year, hence the importance of being clear about the requirements that the college sector has for capital funding going forward and the priority that those have alongside other priorities so that ministers can make the appropriate decisions about how to allocate resource.
But my interpretation of page 26 of the Auditor General report I think slightly contradicts what you've just said, because they have said that the current method of allocating capital funding does not take account of the college's need, and this is due to an absence of a complete and up-to-date national condition survey of the college sector estate. So I think what the Auditor General is saying is it's not because of the Queen Elizabeth Hospital and it's not because of the bridge, it's because your government hasn't actually done an audit of the state of the college estate across the country, and that's why capital money isn't being allocated. Would you agree with that?
I think there are two elements of capital funding we're talking about here. One is the capital that is allocated out to each college each year as part of the capital maintenance, and whether the issue is whether that should be focused towards colleges that have greater need, i.e. older buildings and so on, or spread equally across the sector to maintain the good buildings and, you know, as good estates so they don't become bad buildings. That is one issue. There's a separate issue about how you focus the major capital projects on, you know, new estates. And well, the most recent one that we're working on is in Falkirk, the City of Glasgow College and so on. These are ones you know, where there is a major capital project costing many tens of millions, and that's different from the capital maintenance which goes across the whole sector. We accept the Auditor General's point that looking at how the capital maintenance is used is an issue as well as looking at how you focus on the big estates projects.
I would have to emphasise though that for many years, and it's continuing even now, there is a process of close engagement between government, funding council and colleges around the capital requirements that exist, and funding decisions are made accordingly. That's not to detract from the fact that I think the Auditor General has made a valid and important point about ensuring that there is a comprehensive and very clearly defined national picture of the college estate. I accept the need for that and work is being done, but I would want to emphasise that there has been a great deal of ongoing engagement around the requirements of the sector, as I say, within the difficult overall financial envelope.
So you're confident that overall picture across Scotland is going to improve, so in the future we'll have a better idea of requirements?
I'm confident that the work is being done around the overall picture. As clearly as an official in front of you today, I cannot make any statements about what the capital allocations will be. Ultimately, that will be a matter for this Parliament. But the work will be the data gathering is being done and should lead to the improvements that the Auditor General recommends.
Okay, thank you both. Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Convener, and apologies for my late arrival. It's probably for the best that we're not scrutinising the train service this morning. Yes, we'll leave that for another day. So clearly I've missed some of the earlier questions and answers, but just to pick up on some of the points that Liam Kerr was asking about, and in a previous session I've asked specifically about the impact on part-time courses. Am I right that this reduction in part-time courses, that was a a deliberate course of action? Is that an intended consequence?
I can see a little from a government perspective, and it maybe we're going over some of the ground that we covered, but really, as far back as 2009, a policy decision was made to focus more on courses that would lead to recognised qualifications. And the figures I've seen indicate that now around 97% of activity leads to a recognised qualification. So there was a deliberate decision in light of the demand that existed for places and the financial context of the time to focus on courses that would lead to a recognised qualification. Aligned to that, there was a decision to place a significant focus on the needs of young people in the 16 to 24 category and to ensure that priority was given to accessing college placements for those young people, again, in response to a careful consideration of the overall economic picture and indeed a recognition that youth unemployment had to be tackled. And from some of the figures which we now see, I think we can see that those decisions around recognised qualifications and prioritising young people have had a positive impact. But I would also emphasise that it remains the case that short courses and learning opportunities for older learners is absolutely something that colleges provide.
Okay, so we're running a little bit short of time. Can I ask both members and witnesses to keep their answers a bit more pithy? Thank you.
Okay, I think John Kemp earlier said that it was a squeezing out of courses. So was that done in the awareness that it would squeeze out women disproportionately, adult learners, those with caring responsibilities? It was done in that full knowledge?
One of the answers I gave earlier, perhaps before you arrived, is we acknowledge, as is referred to in the Auditor General's report, we did not do a full equality impact assessment in 2009. We had done some modelling work internally, but our aim was to squeeze out courses that did not lead to a recognised qualification and were all often very short. We're talking a couple of hours.
Just to be clear, why wasn't the equality impact assessment undertaken and who made that decision?
It was an error. We should have done it. We should have reported that to our council. We didn't.
Was it considered and dismissed, or was it just not considered at all?
No, it wasn't considered. It was an error by the executive of the Scottish Funding Council in that, you know, we in the council paper, we should have put an equality impact assessment in. We have checked. We did do some analysis, but we haven't reported that to the council. We didn't do it. It was simply an error.
I would want to emphasise, though, that equality impact assessments have subsequently been carried out. I have some in front of me, and we could share them with the committee if that would be helpful. So they were carried out from 2011 onwards, but absolutely, as John has said, one should also have been carried out in 2009.
Okay. Is there a retrospective aspect to that, or is that just looking at the impact of future decisions?
Well, the retrospective aspect is we have obviously looked at the data. I mean, it's been a very live, it was looked at as part of the 2011 work. So yes, I mean, it has been looked at many times since then, but at the point that we took the decision in 2009, we accept there wasn't a full equality impact assessment done.
And if I could just add, as of now, what is very important is that we get an overarching picture across Scotland of the demand that exists for college places. And that is something that the Funding Council is carrying out with Colleges Scotland.
Okay. In the report we have from NUS today, they tell us there's a very real risk of excluding those students who most deserve a college place but simply aren't able to study full time. And they say that the Auditor General's report, it's a worrying trend. Are you worried about that?
The trend of shifting between full-time and part-time has flattened in the last couple of years, so the trend isn't continuing. But I would stress that there is still a very substantial amount of part-time provision in the college sector. The courses that have been removed were very short and often didn't lead to a recognised qualification. So, I mean, had we been looking back and have a full equality impact assessment, we'd have probably reached exactly the conclusion we did. At the moment, there is provision for part-time courses in colleges for the valuable part-time of the kind that the NUS is talking about. We need to constantly work with colleges to ensure that the balance is right and that, that the courses are available and that our funding incentives are the right ones. But there is still considerable capacity for part-time in colleges.
Computing and health, where places have fallen by almost half. That's in page 9 of the report.
These would have been very short courses.
Okay, so the people who would have gone on those courses, how are they acquiring those skills? Are you saying that they're in full-time courses?
I would imagine that the drops in those two subjects in the very short courses would have been almost leisure courses in health, or they would have been, you know, how to, you know, computing for the terrified type courses, often of which continue to exist, but are paid for by the students.
Okay. Can I just pick up one more point in relation to staffing? Unison have also submitted a report, and apologies if this has been covered by anyone else, but I was quite struck by Unison's report, Learning the Hard Way, and that tells us that staff are under pressure, morale is very low, trust in management is at rock bottom. And I think there's a good point made in the report. It says further education is all about people. Education cannot be delivered by robots. It's quite a dark picture being painted about the atmosphere and what it's like for staff.
In my opening statement, I did say that one of the reasons the mergers had been successful was down to the very hard work of the staff. I think we recognise, and it's come out of the post-merger evaluations, that the period of change in the college sector over the last few years has been demanding for staff. And we also talked about how, you know, sometimes when we spoke to staff in post-merger evaluations, they were telling us that, but there are different perceptions of, you know, how bad it was and, you know, whether it's improved. But I take your point. We recognise it's very important that, you know, the staff in colleges are well motivated, well supported, because as they say, it can't be done by robots.
So I don't think there's any doubt that staff are working very hard, but I think the concern is that they're in danger of burning out. Is that a concern that you share?
I think if Colleges Scotland had been available on the panel, they could have talked a bit more about how their perception of the pressures on staff. From our post-merger evaluations, I don't think it would be fair to say that we perceived it as bad, as you suggest there. But we do recognise those pressures are there.
Does Mr. Johnson recognise
it? I would certainly add that I absolutely recognise that effective leadership is crucial. That's one of the lessons that the Funding Council does bring out in its overarching report on the success of mergers. There's some good case studies there about examples of college leadership really engaging well with staff and supporting staff. And what I would hope to see is lessons being learned and for college leaders to be supporting, developing, and equipping their staff to really thrive in the future.
Thank you. Of course, those same staff, Mr. Johnson, are currently in dispute over pay. Do you have any comment on that?
My comment really would be that work is ongoing in relation to pay. We're working very closely with both the Funding Council and Colleges Scotland in relation to the pay issues. And of course, we will indeed ensure that the Parliament is kept updated as discussions continue. I don't know if John would want to add anything on that.
We have been supporting Colleges Scotland and the Employers Association with some additional funding so that they have the capacity to take forward those negotiations in the best possible way. But that's largely an issue between the employers and their staff. But we are supporting that from outside with the capacity so that negotiations proceed smoothly.
There is an issue of equality between support staff's pay rise and that of lecturers, so I hope there's an agreement reached quite swiftly. Can I turn to a point that Monica Lennon and Liam Kerr also raised about equality impact assessments? Mr. Johnson, is it not a statutory duty on your government to carry out an equality impact assessment?
The statutory duties that I think you'd be referring to were in the Equalities Act 2010, and absolutely those duties are very important, and as Dr. Kemp has recognised, it is important that equality impact assessments are carried out whenever policy changes are made that could have an impact on. So, what I think we've recognised is that in 2009, there should have been an equalities impact assessment, and there was not one done at that point. But what I would seek to emphasise is both the subsequent equalities impact assessments that have been carried out and the ongoing work that the Funding Council carries out with individual colleges around equalities. When you look at some of the regular reporting from the Funding Council, I've been struck by the volume of information that is actually gathered, analysed and reported around the support that colleges are providing to those with a whole variety of protected characteristics.
Seems like a huge and significant omission on the part of your government. The colleges provide education, training and skills for large parts of our population, and I think we've all had people coming to our surgery not able any longer to access college courses because of this decision. So for it to be an oversight or an omission seems very serious, given that it's a statutory duty. Don't you agree?
Well, could I emphasise that my point about the fact that there wasn't one available in 2009, and also the fact that a number of the duties which we now refer to were in the Equalities Act 2010. But that is not to say that I am seeking to gloss over the fact that an equalities impact assessment should have been produced in 2009, and that's certainly in the territory of where we need to ensure that in future all of the policy changes that could have an equalities impact are fully assessed. But I would have to emphasise the ongoing work that has been done since then to take full account of the equalities impacts of the policies that are being pursued.
Including in 2011 of putting learners at the centre, which was the key kind of policy that led to the reform programme, that was equality impact assessed.
Mr Johnson, do you expect a subsequent legal challenge on the absence of an equality impact assessment in 2009?
I don't think I'd want to comment on that issue. I think I've set out our position on the extent to which equalities issues have been considered thoroughly in recent years and will continue to be considered very carefully.
Okay. Can I ask about workforce planning? It's page 25 of the report, paragraph 57. Conveners met with the First Minister yesterday, and I was pointing out to her that so many of the themes across Audit Scotland's report come up time and time again. I think workforce planning is an issue across the public sector, but it seems to me that, you know, it says in this report there is limited evidence of systematic workforce planning in our colleges. Do you know why this is?
Well, my starting point would be to again emphasise that I accept the need for that workforce planning to be carried out, and I recognise also that that's not a recommendation that's limited only to this sector, and I hope you will see, as a committee, you will see that the evidence of that workforce planning taking place, and I know that's something that's being carried out between the Funding Council and Colleges Scotland.
Yeah. It's a recommendation we will take forward with the colleges.
It is being taken forward.
Yes, yeah.
Okay, thank you. Can I ask finally, before I bring in Alison Harris, for our final question about demand, student demand. This is something that greatly concerns me. It was a couple of years ago I raised this issue in Parliament that in the autumn, Dundee and Angus College, which is in my region, had over 800, I think it was 818 young people who were not able to get a place to do engineering at the college, and all these students were turned away. As you know, of course, there is no data gathering system to see what these young people have gone on to do, if they've taken alternative routes. This concerns me on a number of levels. I mean, in terms of our economy and the skills needs of our economy, that there is not a system in place across the country that actually records demand of students. Can you tell me how this has been tackled?
We are working with Colleges Scotland and with the government on a systematic way of understanding the applications to each college by subject so that we can compare them across Scotland and understand where there are disparities in demand. It's the kind of thing that can be done very easily in universities because there's one application system. It's more complex in colleges because they have different systems. However, we have piloted work with some colleges, including Dundee and Angus, on ways of doing that. What we now need to do is roll that out to all of the other colleges and make sure it's done, you know, sector-wide so that we have an understanding of, you know, who's applying for what courses and what the outcomes are. And that will tell us something about, you know, the level of demand for courses. I would stress that as well as that, we've been doing work looking at the demography of different areas, the proportions going to universities, the proportions in work and so on, so that we understand which areas, and then comparing that with the supply of places, so that we understand which areas might have a need for more activity and which might not. And we have been moving activity from areas of lower demand to areas of higher demand over the last couple of years, so that increasingly our funding is needs-based. But we don't have the same kind of data that we do have in the university sector, but we hope to move towards something like that.
I think, Convener, if I may just add, I think it's an important point you've raised, and it is one that is being addressed. I think it's also an area where a smaller number of larger colleges of scale operating with real clarity as to the requirements of a region are able to help secure real progress.
I don't think there's any time scale on that work. Are you able to put a time scale on that?
We would intend to have the system in place for recording all of the students by the time that students are making applications for 2017. Because 2016 is now passed.
Okay, thank you. Alison Harris.
Yes, just very briefly, firstly, my apologies for being so late this morning, totally out with my control. Yeah, I hope this hasn't been asked, but what concerns me is I'm wondering whether you think that there are potential indicators that the Scottish Government's focus on the courses leading to employment really have not been that successful in light of the fact of low and reducing percentage leavers going into employment.
Pick that up earlier, but I'm happy to recap very briefly, which is to emphasise that the most recent figures for positive destinations are up. So overall, there's an increase. We only have 2 years of data, and absolutely the most recent year's data shows a small drop in those going into employment, but an increase in those going on to further courses. And as we've discussed, the nature of further education is often the fact that the learner is on a journey, which may involve a number of courses in a pathway leading to employment. However, what we also recognise is our need to keep a really close eye on that positive destination figure, and that is data that will now be gathered on a year-on-year basis.
Thank you. Apologise for recovering that and missing that. Thank you.
Can I thank you both very much indeed for your evidence this morning? I'm now going to suspend the committee for 5 minutes for the witnesses to change and for a comfort break. I move on to item three, which is our evidence session on the Auditor General for Scotland's report entitled the 2014-15 Audit of Edinburgh College. And I welcome to the meeting Annette Bruton, Principal and Chief Executive, and Alan Williamson, Chief Operating Officer, both Edinburgh College. Good morning. Chris Brown, the Head of Audit and Assurance of Scotland Creef, the Internal Auditor for the College. Hugh Harvey, Partner, KPMG, who carried out the external audit, and Dr. John Kemp, Interim Chief Executive of the Scottish Funding Council. I invite Annette Bruton to make an opening statement, followed by Dr. Kemp, before I open up to questions from members. I understand that no other witnesses wish to make an opening statement, is that correct? Okay. Annette.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning, and thank you for the opportunity to give evidence to the Committee on the matter of the Auditor-General's report on Edinburgh College. As the Committee will have seen from our submission, we accept the report, and we've been taking action both before and after the report was published to address the problems that led to the failure to deliver the agreed delivery targets and the ensuing serious financial problems faced by the reduction in budget. The Auditor-General explained to the Committee previously the arrangements for funding both core and additional activity in colleges, but we're very happy to clarify this further if the Committee wishes us to. I took up my post in the summer of last year, and since that time we've focused our efforts on understanding the nature of the problems facing Edinburgh College, and in particular in relation to the recruitment and retention of the right number of students. I believe we've made some good progress to date on this, and we're working hard to ensure that our students experience a high level of support to gain the qualifications they need for future jobs. We're a large college with over 700 vocational and academic courses. We have good evidence of success that results from the hard work of our staff and students. For example, 99% of our successful full-time students move on to employment or further study within 6 months of graduating. Alongside that, however, we recognise there are other areas of our performance that need to significantly improve. There's still much to do in the short and medium term. These actions include putting in place new courses for the future and critically reducing our budget deficit to achieve a balanced position. Our three-year transformation plan has been shared and shaped by staff, students and our partners. We recognise that the work for this will be difficult, challenging and will require determination and sustained effort to improve the college's position and ensuring that we are financially stable for the future. We've summarised in our submission what we believe are the key points that led to the college's past performance difficulties and how we're addressing these. I'd be happy, however, to give much more detail as required and answer the committee's questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Dr. Kemp.
Thank you again for inviting me here with colleagues from Edinburgh College to discuss the Auditor General's report. Can I first say that the issues at Edinburgh, that Edinburgh College are facing are deep-seated, and we're working closely with Annette and our team to address these through the Business Transformation Plan. The underlying financial issue that faces Edinburgh College is that the activity target at the college was greater than the college could meet. The college has recognised this over several years and has agreed gradual reductions in activity, which has been moved to areas with higher demand since 2012. However, a year ago, the current principal wrote to us asking that the target be reduced in year by a far larger amount than had been previously agreed, around 12,000 credits. We supported that move and have assisted the business transformation plan that will enable the college to be financially sustainable at the lower activity target. The issues regarding additionality and the subsequent clawback are a contributing factor to the financial difficulties, but there are wider issues too. I'm very happy to answer your questions, both about the additionality and about how we're working with the college to address the issues.
Thank you very much. Colin Beattie is going to open questioning for us.
Thank you, Mayor. I'd like to have a look at additionality first. I mean, clearly it's not the only problem the college has got, but I'd like to look a little bit at the timelines here and how it was handled. Now, according to what I have here, SFC issued the funding activity guidance to colleges on the 22nd of July 2014. Who received that in Edinburgh College?
Convener, that would have gone to the vice principals. There were two vice principals who had responsibility for the curriculum, one with responsibility for the curriculum and one responsible for the frameworks on which the curriculum is built. So that guidance would have gone to those members of the senior team.
And what would they do with it? Or what did they do with it?
What they should have done was cross-check the current curriculum frameworks against what was now allowed in terms of additionality. And that's an audit that I would expect would happen every year. We've done two in-depth audits since I've come into post, following that guidance and following what we now know was a problem for the college. I do believe that an exercise was carried out, but not in sufficient depth or with enough outcomes to change the curriculum frameworks in time for the recruitment for the year that was about to start.
But would not the question of additionality be fairly obvious? It would be quite evident there was a problem?
Well, there were two components to the additionality, if memory serves me, on that particular guidance, which was issued just as I was coming into post. The first one was that there was a percentage figure allowed, and then there was an additional amount allowed that could be agreed with your outcome manager. So it wasn't just a fixed amount.
Again, looking at the timeline I've got here, it says between August 2014 and October 2014, the college monitored and reported on activity to both SFC and the board. Now, you sent reporting to SFC. Would that reporting have indicated there was a difficulty with additionality?
So the college reports to SFC four times a year in a formal return that goes in, and that return is also reported to the board. You wouldn't pick up the additionality being over the allowed amount unless the curriculum frameworks on which it was based had been properly audited. So assumptions were made that amounts of additionality were allowed within the curriculum frameworks we have. So each curriculum has an amount of points, really, that you're allowed to accumulate on it. And because that hadn't been done thoroughly for each area, then assumptions were made that additionality was allowed, and that was reported in good faith. But on checking the guidance, when I came into post and checking the guidance, I found that many of our curriculum frameworks were over-applying that rule and some were under-applying it. But overall, there was an over-claiming on additionality because the curriculum hadn't been changed.
Dr. Kemp, wouldn't SFC have picked something up from these reports?
In the case of the... Well, on the Fed's reports, you wouldn't automatically pick up the additionality from those returns, though you can by looking, you know, if you know what you're looking for. But in the case of Edinburgh College, that had been picked up through discussions with the outcome agreement manager and the college, aside from the looking at the statistics, and it had been discussed with managers and the college during the period that Annette's talking about.
When the SFC... funding and activity guidance came out, it went to the two vice principals. Would it automatically go to internal audit?
Internal audit would be using the same guidance as the college.
Which means?
Yes.
Yes, they would have received it.
Yes.
Can I ask if internal audit did receive it?
No, internal audit don't automatically receive all guidance that goes to colleges, no. So the college is...
You don't receive the guidances that come to the college from SFC?
We don't automatically... No, we don't get it from SFC.
How can you do your job?
Because the college gives us the guidance or draws our attention to the guidance, to the existence of the guidance. So in this case, what we had to do is go onto the Funding Council's website and download the guidance from the Funding Council's website.
When did you do that?
Just before we did the audit, or during the course of the planning for the audit. So in this case, the audit takes place after the end of the year, so shortly before.
So are you saying but that would have been by the end of 2014?
Yeah.
There should have been evidence there was a problem because you were doing the audit as at the end of the year, presumably, or is it the end of the? But what is your end of year?
So it's the end of the 2014-15 academic year.
Which month?
Which would be July 2015.
So July 2015, you would have picked this up?
Yes.
Did you?
As part of the audit programme, as part of the guidance that the Funding Council issues, and the guidance is 45 pages long, and the requirements, the new requirements around additionality were put in for the first time in 14-15 into that guidance. And
it's included in that 45-page document?
I think it's in paragraphs 84 and 85 of that document. So
45 pages is not exactly War and Peace.
No, it's not, but it doesn't jump out at you as a new requirement. But the Funding Council does include in the guidance suggested audit tests, none of which actually refer to additionality.
Would you have expected use the word audit tests to come from SFC?
Yeah, that's typically what they do. The audit guidance comes from the Funding Council because it's an audit that the Funding Council requires us to do. So what they do is they summarise in the guidance the kinds of tests that they want us to carry out as part of that. They summarise the kinds of tests that they want the colleges to ask their internal auditors to carry out on their behalf.
But if you're the internal auditors, are you saying you only look at the position once a year?
We do an annual audit of the student activity, which is an audit that happens after the end of the year.
But your ongoing internal audit programme is only at the end of a year. So only at the end of the year do you download the directions from the SFC that you're going to be measuring people against?
No, the annual internal audit programme happens throughout the course of the year.
So you would. So how often do you download or check that you've received all the directives that you need?
So we do that on an audit by audit basis.
But you just told me you do it at the end of the year.
For that particular audit, because that particular audit happens after the end of the year. So when we're doing the planning for the audit, for the whole audit programme, we try and make ourselves aware of the key guidance changes and the key bits of information that we need to be aware of to allow us to do the audit.
So it would not have been possible for you to pick this up in the course of the year?
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. So one of the audits that we did include in that year, in 14-15, because the internal audit programme is based on risk, one of the highest risks to the college, actually most colleges, was and still is the risk of them not having enough students, not recruiting enough students. So we did an audit in January 2015, which looked at how the college management were using the student activity data that was coming out of the system to make changes to the curriculum and how they were doing that to take action to recruit enough students if they were underperforming on students.
Just been told that the college reports four times a year to SFC, which would have included information on additionality. Do you see these returns at all?
We're not formally given those returns, so they would be in.
You don't get the returns that go to SFC?
No, they'd be included.
That plays no part in your audit?
No, they'd be included in the board papers, which we get access to.
And what do you do with the board papers?
So typically what we do is review what's going through the board. We'll not read every single paper that goes to the board. But
you don't read them all? Are they so extensive?
Well, the board packs are long. So what we're doing is we're working with the college and we're working with the audit committee, which is a subcommittee of the board. We attend all of the audit committee meetings throughout the year, and we work with them to try and identify the key areas that we want to focus on as part of the internal audit programme. So the audit committee, being a subcommittee of the board, includes board members, the principal, the director of corporate services, typically attend those audit committee meetings, and that's the kind of forum for us to agree what we should include in the audit programme or any changes we need to make to the audit programme.
Can I ask Dr. Kemp, the SFC, why was it that no tests were issued against this for internal audit? They're just saying that it's normal course for that to happen. It didn't happen in this case.
I will check the guidance, but my recollection is, the guidance was fairly clear on what was allowable activity and what wasn't, and the systems round about it. It's worth stressing, though, that this is not a new issue. This is not something that was introduced in 2014. There have been related study rules as part of the old funding systems, and they are now part of the new funding system. All that's changed is the definition of how you define a full time and what is over and above that. So this is something that most colleges have been dealing with for many years.
I think we've understood that the college missed this.
Yeah.
It's a question of what are the mechanisms that was in place that should have picked this up and why it wasn't?
Well, in this case, I mean, the college, as well as what was published in the guidance, were verbally and through several meetings told about the rule by their outcome manager.
They were told about it?
Yeah. I mean, as well as the publication of the guidance and so on, there was discussion of the issue.
So who specifically would have been told about this?
It was, from our point of view, it was our outcome manager who was dealing with it. Annette, who was it?
Through you, Convener. When I came into post, I looked at this in some detail and I found evidence. This was one of the things that I picked up quite quickly in post, that there was a problem with our curriculum frameworks. And we began working on that within a couple of months of me being in post. I wanted to look into this to see what had gone wrong. And there was certainly evidence of the outcome agreement manager having had discussions with several different people in the executive team about reducing that additionality over time. And some of that had been done, but not sufficient to meet the guidelines that were issued in 2014. So although we were discussing there what the auditor might pick up at the end of the year, I picked that up through the work of some of the senior team I was directing when I came into post.
So it wasn't the auditors that brought it to your attention?
I picked it up as part of a review I was having done of the curriculum frameworks, because I could see with the recruitment problems we were having with students, something was wrong with them.
But it wasn't the auditors that brought it to your attention?
That wasn't brought to my attention by the auditors at that stage, although the auditors did do some work on it later.
But you already knew about it by the time the auditors came to you?
I picked it up through through two routes. One, a review I'd asked for of the curriculum frameworks, because there were two issues. One, I wanted to know about how much additionality was in our curriculum frameworks. And secondly, I wanted to know that our curriculum frameworks generally were complying with all of the rules that are set, because I was worried that we weren't recruiting, and I wanted to know what the curriculum frameworks look like. So that was one of the things that we picked up, and one of the reasons that we went to the funding council to ask them to reduce our target in year. I didn't know the full extent of the additionality until further work had been done later in the year and had that verified by the audit team.
I'm looking here at, again, at the timeline I've got here. It says 10th of October 2015. You had a deadline for returning data for funding purposes to the SSC, and that this was accompanied by an audit certificate and report provided by internal audit. What did that audit certificate and report signify? What did it say? Did it agree with the figures? Did it agree it was compliant?
Yes,
it did. So it said that the college was complying with SFC guidelines. Clearly it was not.
No, by that time, the college had amended its certificate, because the funding council had identified the issue about additionality, about the excessive use of additionality. So they'd taken the 5,000 approximately weighted sums out of the claim, and they had signed an amended certificate. So when we signed our audit certificate, it was accurate, and the college's claim was accurate. So all of that is described in our report, which accompanies our audit certificate, which we submitted to the college.
And was that the point, really, at which SFC were aware there was a problem?
We were aware of the problem around a year before that.
The year before that?
Yes.
So you knew about it before internal audit?
Yeah, our outcome manager would have been had discussions that I've got in November 2014.
November 2014, you were aware there was a problem?
Yes.
And internal audit wasn't aware until July or whatever, 2015. The incoming principal found it before internal audit picked it up. It does seem odd. The timing doesn't look good.
So we do audits at a particular point in time, and so we report on what we found in that audit at that point in time. So, you know, everything that we reported in our audit in October, November 2015 was absolutely accurate. That doesn't mean to say we weren't aware of the issues before then, but we hadn't done the sums audit. The sums audit happens
every year. You told me you weren't aware before.
No, what I said
was... You told me you were only aware when you downloaded, at the end of the financial year, when you downloaded the 45 pages from the website.
Well, what we weren't aware of was the specific guidance that the Funding Council had issued to us to allow us to do the sums audit. But we were aware before then of the Funding Council and the College's discussions around One Plus activity.
Wouldn't that have triggered a thought in your head that you need to look into it a bit more?
So we did look into it. So the underlying issue here that the College has is that it's under recruiting students. So it's not recruiting sufficient numbers of students. And it's known about that issue for a number of years. It's been in the College's risk register for a number of years. Our audit plan is based on the College's risk register. So we had an audit in that financial year, in the 2014-15 financial year, that we agreed with the audit committee and with management, which we carried out in January of 2015, which looked at how the College took action when it identified that it was under recruiting students, and what action it took and how it reported that action to the executive and to the board. So we flagged up as part of the audit programme the underlying issues which were causing, which were at least contributing to the College not being able to recruit sufficient students. The outcome of that was that the College recognised, okay, so we're under recruiting. At that point in January, there were something like 43,000 sums below their target. So they had a lot of recruitment to do, and the College was able to recruit a large number of students. But one of the things that it did to increase its activity was it applied more activity to some of its existing students in breach of some of the Funding Council's guidelines.
I think there's a bit of a circular argument on timing here, but I'll leave it to that just now.
Alex Neil.
Can I, first of all, just pick this up with the... I think Mr Williamson used to be the Director of Finance, was your previous title. So here we have this problem. The Funding Council's aware of it in the College in 2014. The auditors pick it up in mid-2015. The new principal picks it up. You're the Director of Finance. When did you know about the problem and what did you do about it?
Well, throughout the year, there's generally quite a lot of work that's been undertaken when you're looking at additionality. So any additionality changes that go through would go through the reporting. And there was certainly a belief that the reporting that we were looking at included any agreed additionality with the Funding Council. And that was from my perspective.
So when did you realise this problem existed?
Well, the problem really came out towards the final FES return, which was around about the October time. 15. So that's right. A final FES return, and it became much more apparent that there were difficulties with the additionality claim that we had put in.
And when had the guidance come out?
Well, the guidance came out, that was in June in 14.
So why did it take all that time for you to highlight that?
Well, it wasn't a case for me highlighting it. The actual guidance was given to all the executives. And the vice principals of curriculum and quality are there to implement the changes to the frameworks through the staff. And using that procedure, I rely on the reports that I receive from that and the information I'm given through reporting.
I have to say, sitting here, it looks like a total failure. The Funding Council's aware of the problem. Did the Funding Council not go into you and say, you've got a problem here?
Well, the Funding Council were liaising through the Outcome Agreement Manager with the Vice Principals. I didn't.
So nobody from the Funding Council got on to you and said you've got a financial problem here?
Not to me. I would rely on the information internally.
It seems to me there's an awful lot of cooks in this bit of broth and nobody seems to be in charge and looking at the whole system. I think there's fundamental systemic issues that need to be addressed here. How much money does the College spend on audit?
On audit, probably about $35,000 a year, $40,000.
And how much does the Funding Council spend on audit?
I don't have that information.
Right. I suspect a lot more than 35. Yeah. It seems to me we've got a lot of people but nobody seems to be talking to others.
Let's be clear, the funding council was speaking to almost all of the senior management team at various times. The vice principals responded, the two vice principals who had curriculum responsibility, and the deputy principal at that time. It would have been well known to the people in the college responsible for the curriculum
framework.
You're
all sitting passing the buck. Who at the end of the day should have picked this up, when it should have been picked up and done something about it? You're all passing the buck.
Well, we're fairly clear. We spoke to the college in 2014, towards the latter part of 2014, while the activity was still going on. We indicated it was an issue, and when that came through, that still hadn't been addressed at the time the final FES came in, we clawed back money because we felt they had not abided by the rules on either 1+ or related study.
I mean,
it's in direct response to Mr. Neil's question. There were management mistakes made by the college, and I think we need to be clear about that, that actually the college should have picked up that guidance and they should have taken action. And one of the problems I found when I went to the college was that the management structure was getting in the way of somebody taking ultimate responsibility for that. We've changed that since. We now have a clear lead and responsibility on everything to do with credit, application, curriculum and so on. So I took quite quick action, supported by the board, to make sure that we got that structure into the right shape. Now, never say never. It's highly unlikely that would happen now because it goes to a single person rather than different people. And also we've made the lines of accountability much clearer. But to answer Mr. Neil's question, there were management errors made in the college because that should have been picked up and dealt with.
Can I ask, how many full-time equivalent permanent lecturers now work at the college, and how does that compare to the last couple of years?
I'm sorry, I don't have that information with me. It's in the region of 547, I think. But I don't have the information in front of me at the moment.
Right. And has there been an increase or decrease in the number of lecturing staff recent years, given that you've been under recruiting students? You don't know?
I don't know, because the number of lecturing staff, FTE, changes year on year.
Right.
So we have some people in a permanent contract, some people in part-time. Some people only work for 2 or 3 days a week. Some people come in for just one semester to deliver short full-time. We do have the figure. I just don't have it with me. I'm sorry.
Can you maybe
we can make that available
in each of the last two years?
Indeed.
Please.
Yep.
Can I say, I've since the last hearing we had in Edinburgh College, quite a number of people have written to me and to members of the committee. Let me just read out some of the comments. Now, I don't know if these comments reflect reality or not, but I'm going to give you, since they're circulating widely, I'm going to give you some of the most disturbing ones and give you the opportunity to tell me if they're right or wrong. There's 4 or 5 in this, so bear with me just a second. The first allegation, if I could put it that way, is almost all the heads of department took voluntary severance in 2016, and a new set of heads have just been recruited, most with no previous experience of further education. Point number one. Point number two, there is no government control over this, quote, super-inflated pay for the senior management team or principals. Three, the lack of an organisation chart helps obscure the number of staff working on projects. These are hand-picked staff, as project opportunities are not advertised. For example, a curriculum head was hand-picked to improve the enrolment system. The result was the worst ever student recruitment year and a £3 million SFC clawback. And the final one I have here, the principal's response, and I don't know if this is referring to the current principal, yourself, Annette, or the previous one, was to promote the head to a new job title, associate principal, with no interview and no job advert. Are these allegations true?
I'll try and take them in turn, convener. We did have a change in structure, as I've just explained to the committee, because we had problems with lines of accountability. And I wanted the heads of faculty, who are actually running very, very big teams. So, for example, our head of health, wellbeing, and social science runs a part of the organisation that's bigger than Borders College, for example. So I needed to change the responsibility levels of those heads. The majority of the heads of faculty have changed. Three of those heads were promoted internally to assistant principal posts, so they didn't leave on VS. From recollection, I think two of the heads left on VS, and that was because their post had been deleted from the structure. We actually have fewer heads now than we had before, and we've invested that money in frontline staff and frontline leadership in creating a new leadership role in frontline staff. In terms of the no control over, the government has no control over superinflated salary levels, Dr. Kent might want to come back onto that later on. There is an organisational chart for the college, and it's published on our intranet for staff. I don't want to comment on what I think are potentially malicious comments about an individual that's been made there. I certainly recruited someone to help with recruitment and retention because they were already working on a project on that when I arrived in the college, and I thought they were making a good job of it. And that person was interviewed by me to see if they would be suitable to do that project.
Can I just go back to the lecturer's issue? Because the information we have is, in terms of full-time equivalent, in 2011-12, you had a total staffing complement, obviously you weren't there, Annette, at that time, of 1,165.8 people, of whom 517 were lecturing staff, and that was 44% of staff. In 2015-16, that figure was 1,162, of whom only 504, that's 13 less than previously, were lecturing staff, down to, so 41% of staff, as opposed to previously 44%, were lecturing staff. Is that not all going in the wrong direction?
I can provide you with the more detailed figures, but there were two or three things were influencers in there. So, for example, again, I'm reporting what I have subsequently known because I wasn't there at the time, so I need to be very careful. But there was a new post created in the college after merger, the post of learning and development tutors, who took on some of the roles of lecturing staff, which freed lecturing staff up to do teaching and preparation, and they did more of the administration and student support work. So the balance between those people who were working directly with students and lecturing staff changed. There were other things that influenced the number of, from my analysis, there are other things that have influenced the number of staff working in the college. So for example, the college made the decision to bring catering back in-house for a couple of reasons. One, we thought we'd get better value and we'd save money, but also we thought we'd get better quality and that would provide opportunities for the catering staff to work alongside the students who were learning in hospitality. So actually, although we were decreasing in some areas of the college in terms of voluntary severance, for example, we were increasing in other areas where we got better value and where a decision was made that actually it was better to have our catering in-house than out at a private company. So there's a lot of nuances underneath those figures, and with your permission, convener, I would write to the committee to give you some of the detail that I have on that.
Can I just, on the catering thing, my understanding is between February and June you made, or probably more, but you certainly the internal catering seemed to operate a surplus, which is welcome news, but apparently there was a commitment that that would be reinvested in improving the canteen facilities and the quality of the food and so on, and there's a feeling that that hasn't happened. Is that correct?
I think Mr. Williamson might be able to say something about it. We've got currently got a catering review ongoing involving the students and staff.
Yeah, we do have a catering review ongoing, and we're actually going to be investing in some of the catering equipment coming up as well. But ultimately, I think the shops in the colleges were far better stocked. The atrium area is far better than it was before. So there has been investment in it, and the actual surplus is very small anyway.
Yeah. Can I just finally come back to the issue of the, I think, is it 50 learner development tutor posts? My understanding is it says in the information I have, they do not teach, they do not provide academic tutorials. There's no record of how many students they see in any 1 week, and no other job has this job title. Is that all true? And my final question is, how many agency workers have you got?
I'm not sure that I know how many agency workers we have, but I'll let Alan give you an indication of the kind of areas where we might need agency staff. He'll say if I'm right or not. Usually that's just for cover when someone is off sick, but Alan can make a comment on that. In terms of the learning and development tutors, we have learning and development tutors, we have student support services, and we have specialists who work with students with additional support needs. That's currently under review. But just to give you an idea of what learning development tutors will do, they will meet with class groups or individuals on a weekly basis. They support pastoral care. They do a similar job to the job that guidance teachers would do in school. But they also support career development for students. But we know that there'll be opportunities going forward to look at all of our support services. And our new head of services for students is looking at all of that to see how we can get a better fit with all of these services working together. The LDTs work very closely with the curriculum faculties that they work in.
Okay. And will you write to us on the agency staff, or do you know it offhand?
I'll give you an indication of where we employ agency staff on the occasion. Last year, for example, was in the nursery. There were quite a number of staff on maternity leave. Also within the catering, you sometimes have to pull in staff at very short notice to deal with the volume of students buying food. The leisure facilities that we have in place as well, and similarly anybody given instruction in maybe the gym or the sports, we would use agency staff for that, these purposes, and
you'll
sometimes
send us
facilities.
Detail. You'll send us the detail, will you?
I can send you the details.
Great. Thank you. Kate?
Thank you, Mr. Neil. Liam Kerr.
Thank you. Just to come in to the financial side of things, the college is facing severe financial challenges. Can I just confirm very quickly, there's a £2.5 million funding gap, is that correct?
The drop in activity that was agreed with the college would equate to roughly that sum, yes.
So I just want to look at voluntary severance. It would appear that the cost of the merger was about £17 million, and of that, it would appear voluntary severance has cost about £14.815 million. Just looking at Alec Neil's figures from earlier on, there appears to have been a net change in staff of 3, nearly 4. Doesn't that suggest that there's been a cost of about £4 million per individual shed?
Can I be clear that the figures that were quoted earlier, the ones circulated yesterday, are not ones that we recognise. There are figures on the numbers of staff that left, but they are different from that. And I think Annette's said that she will give you those. Let's be clear, the merger, in our post-merger evaluation, we did an additional one for Edinburgh because we didn't feel it had gone smoothly. Both the current management and the funding council did not feel that the voluntary severance that was done at the time of merger was done as effectively as it could be. So on that issue, I don't think that there is any argument from the senior team or the funding council on that, but we simply don't recognise those figures.
Do you then recognise, so some other figures from a different source that suggest that 18 management staff left by voluntary severance at a cost of £1.8 million, an average of £102,000 per person. Do you recognise those figures?
Sorry, Vina, can I ask Mr Kerr through you, which year are we talking about?
This is saying one reason for the high cost of the merger was the college paid out £1.8 million in voluntary severance to 18 top management individuals. So I haven't the year, but it's relating to the merger itself.
I don't know if Alan can help with that. We don't recognise that.
I'd have to look into the figures.
Let me rephrase it. So do you recognise that 18 management staff have left over the course of the last few years, and if so, how much was paid to them?
I don't have first-hand information about what happened before 2015 when I came, but I can certainly get that information for the committee. There was certainly a significant reduction in middle managers, from my understanding of it, at the point of merger, and that was the main area for reduction of posts with the three colleges coming together. I would also say that I think the way the voluntary severance was managed, looking back on it, and it's always, you have to be careful with hindsight, could have been done differently, and that any voluntary severance we have now is under completely different arrangements and is far, far more cost-effective to the public purse.
Is it, though? Because talk to me about this Edinburgh model, if you would. So how you calculate the voluntary severance.
By that, I take it you're referring to the fact that Edinburgh College offered a far higher number of months per year worked than many other colleges at the time of merger. Most colleges offered something equivalent to, if you'd worked 12 years, you would get a year's salary, a month for a year. Edinburgh's scheme went up to 21 months. The funding council would only fund schemes up to a year's payback. So we'd fund, if you'd worked there 12 years, we would fund up to a year's salary, roughly. But the Edinburgh scheme was a far more generous one. The element over and above the one-year payback was paid by the college itself. It was not something we could control. In current circumstances, we could control now that colleges are part of the public sector, and the current VS schemes that operate in colleges, including Edinburgh College, are at a far lower rate.
What rate?
The broadly payback 1 year. So that if somebody has worked for 12 years, they would get a 1 year.
Yeah.
But it's roughly a year for a month, up to a maximum of 12.
Right.
A month for a year, sorry.
So if one accepts voluntary severance, one will get a month's pay per year of service?
Yes, broadly. I mean, usually the schemes have some banding within that simplifies it, but broadly, yes.
Up to 12 months.
Yeah, up to 12 months.
Over and above a notice period?
In the current agreements, we wouldn't be paying payment in lieu of notice.
We wouldn't pay in lieu of notice. The set notice period is contractual, so people have a contractual notice period. For college reasons, you might want to keep somebody for a longer time or let them go right away. We wouldn't pay for their notice, though. So
just that there has been a significant period during which up to 21 months' pay has been paid, around half of which has been funded by the college. Who took that decision?
The decision to offer 21 months was taken by the then principals and boards of the three colleges. I mean, that was the deal that was on offer at the time of merger.
And what happened to them?
They left.
Under a voluntary severance?
One of them took the post of principal at the college, and the others left.
Oh, sorry, I hadn't realised you were finished. I'll just move on from that to the... I appreciate we're running out of time, perhaps. The student numbers, I picked up... Oh, thank you. I picked up somewhere that student numbers seem to have dropped rather significantly. I'd just like to confirm that. Is that... At the point of merger, there seemed to be 35,000 students.
So, I've been at pains to try and get clear in the public domain where that number 35 came from, because there were never, ever 35,000 students in the three legacy colleges. That figure of 35, I think, is referring to applications. It might have been referring to applications. It might have been referring to individual applicants, but that's not the same as unique students. So last year we had 19,000 unique students. It stayed roughly the same. It went down last year, as you know, because that's one of the reasons it's caused us a financial difficulty. The recruitment was lower last year, but it stayed roughly at that level since merger. I think the confusion came about when the figure of 35,000 applications was published, and what students were able to do at that point in time was to make up to 5 applications to the college. So it was very difficult to tell from the then management information that was around in the college whether that was in fact 35,000 single students and they can only do one course, or that could have been any 35,000 divided by any number up to five, because they could have made more than one application. But the numbers of students coming through the door has stayed roughly consistent with the downturn last year since merger. So we need to be really careful with that figure that persists in coming from some quarters that there were 35,000 students. The other thing that I would say that I can't talk about firsthand, but which I've seen in my review of what's happened, is that the colleges at the point of merger, the legacy colleges of Edinburgh College, at the point of merger, were asked to estimate how many students they thought they would have. And they gave the answer to that in terms of what they expected as applications, which is where I think the 35,000 came from. I don't think, looking back on it, that was a reasonable enough assumption. I think it was over-optimistic. And now that we've done enough with our management information systems in the college to get good data, which I now believe we have got, we can see that student numbers, apart from last year, where there was a real problem with recruitment, have roughly stayed the same, which was the basis for me going to Dr. Kemp earlier in the year and saying that I thought I had good evidence for the need to rebase Edinburgh College lower. And then, if the region demands it, think about growth from there. So there's a lot of confusion in that figure of 35,000. I can say categorically there were never 35,000 students in those three colleges. I think the problem is I don't know. Because the students were counted differently in the different colleges. They had different ways
of
counting.
They were counted.
The sums value of them was counted and reported to the funding council.
I think it's sometimes easy, if you talk about students, you're talking about individual enrolments and headcount, and you know, you can end up with a very large number, some of whom are on very short courses, and it's quite confusing to compare. The underlying issue is Edinburgh College, if you count it in credits, which again is slightly confusing because that's, we start the period in weighted sums and end up in credits. But the underlying issue that we think has affected some of what's happened at Edinburgh College is that demand is not sufficient for the amount of activity that the college has. Now, that is something we'd recognised some years ago, and we had been working through the outcome agreement to reduce the activity at Edinburgh College and move activity to other places where there was higher demand, and that had been operating at a relatively, slow slope down, because we wanted stability in the college as well, and we wanted to understand exactly what demand was in Edinburgh. What Annette, when she came into post, did was review all the curriculum and recognise that that gap was a bit bigger than, had previously been estimated, and asked us to rebase the college. So the numbers of students as defined by credits or FTEs has declined in Edinburgh College, and the drop related to the rebasing was about 6% of the total numbers. But that, we think, is, if I can say this, is in some ways a positive thing, and that we now have a better understanding of what demand is in Edinburgh, so that we can fund that and use the activity that's freed up elsewhere where there might be greater demand and get a better balance between supply and demand across Scotland. But that leaves us all the task to support Edinburgh College through the business transformation plan to get to the right size.
But you presumably wouldn't say, going back to our discussion earlier, that this was a significant fall, whatever it may be, it seems to be a significant fall, in student numbers is a measure of success.
Absolutely not. I mean, let's be clear, when I was talking earlier about the success of the mergers programme, I've been open and honest with Annette and her board on this. Edinburgh is the one college where we think, the merger has not been as well implemented as the other, and our post-merger evaluation is fairly clear on that point.
And just one final point, just on that, Dr. Kemp. So if you accept that the merger has not been as successful, who is responsible and what has happened to them?
Annette is new in post. Much of the senior management team is new in post as well. I mean, there have been changes at the top in Edinburgh College.
Is that all, Mr Kerr?
Yes, thank you.
Alison Harris.
Yes, sorry, just I'm a little confused. When you're sitting there, Dr Kemp, telling me you can't actually tell me how many students, because some are full-time courses, some are part-time courses, and then you go on to talk about demand for courses.
We can tell you the number of students, yes.
Well, was that not a question that somebody asked and we didn't get an answer for?
Convener.
Am I the only one that's confused
Let's
here?
Let's give the witnesses a chance to answer. Annette Bruton.
Thank you very much, Convener. My answer to Mr Kerr was that I can't say with any certainty exactly how many students there were at the point of merger. So just to be clear about that, I'm very clear about how many students we have right now. So at this point in time, we have a little over 15,000 students enrolled for semester one. At the end of last year, we had just over 19,000 students enrolled, and we will anticipate having just slightly above that number for this year.
Right, so that's a much more specific. I totally misunderstood what you were saying.
No.
Threw me off. That's fine. Very important.
Thank you. I'm going to ask a couple of questions. Ms Bruton or Mr Williamson, can you tell me how much has been spent on consultants by Edinburgh College?
It's a very small spend on consultancy. Which year are you talking about? Is it the year just passed?
Yes.
It would be a very small figure. I would probably guess maybe around about 50,000-60,000.
How about over the last few years?
I would have to check.
Okay.
I don't know.
And is that spend, Dr Kemp, more than you would expect in other colleges?
Without seeing the figures, I mean, we're not aware that there's a high spend, and it depends how you define consultants. I mean, that there was an interim principal for a while, that could be defined as a consultancy. Mm-hmm. So, I'm not aware that there has been an out of line spend at Edinburgh College.
Okay, how about spend, Mr. Williamson, on garden leave?
On garden leave.
You're smiling. Why?
Well, I'd have to check that. I would probably say, from recollection, probably about 70,000, I would say. But I would have to check that.
Okay. How many staff, over the last few years have been on garden leave?
Oh, I'd have to check that out as well. Not clear on the number of staff.
Are you aware of any staff being on garden leave?
Previously?
Yes.
Well, I'm aware of one member of staff, yeah.
Okay. Is that usual in the college sector, Dr Kemp, for staff to be on garden leave?
It would not.
I've heard of it in the city, but not in colleges.
It's not usual in the college sector. It would be quite rare, but as with Mr Williams, I'm aware of one case in Edinburgh College.
There's just one case, not more than one?
Well, I'm not aware of any, but I'd have to check.
Okay, fine. Can I ask about PVG checks? What percentage, Ms Bruton, of your staff have been PVG checked?
We're almost up at 100% now. And we've improved. It's a question that if you'd asked us this 6 months ago, it would have been slightly different because we needed to catch up with our PVG checks, but we've put a lot of resources in HR into PVG checking, and we now have improved our systems. And so everyone who had direct contact with students were PVG checked on their way into the college, and we needed to roll over the programme of the re-PVG checking of those who had predated PVG checks. But we've recently had a review of our PVG position, and it's we're now in a very good position with regard to PVG checks.
Okay.
So we're now at the stage where I think I had half a dozen people who previously had the right qualifications and needed to update to PVG. I need to check the exact figures on that. And the PVG system for checking people as they come into post is now well established.
So it was behind, but you've managed to
It was
to
behind
improve.
And we've caught up with that now.
OK, yeah. Good. If I can go back to the topic of additionality, it's this committee's job to follow the public pound as best we can. And it's clear to me and to members that there's things have gone wrong in terms of spend with the public pound at Edinburgh College. I wanted just to delve a little deeper on this. In response to the initial questioning from Colin Beattie, it was very unclear, and I think Mr. Neil said that people were kind of passing the buck in terms of who knew about these guidelines for from the SFC, and that additionality was no longer claimable. Mr. Williamson, can you give me any idea of the number of staff that you think were aware of these guidelines?
Well, the senior team would have been aware, and the heads of the curriculum areas would have been aware. So you're talking about maybe 30-odd staff. Mm-hmm. However, I maybe should emphasise that when these guidelines come in, then there's a lot of work that's undertaken in looking at course frameworks and the subjects on these courses and the attraction of the credits against them, and that's all very much within the curriculum end. And there was a view that that work had been undertaken.
Mm-hmm. And you were part of that senior team?
Well, I was part of the senior team, that's right.
So were you aware of the new guidelines that additionality was no longer claimable?
Well,
it's allowable to claim in some circumstances for additionality. The issue is when that's not previously been agreed with the funding council. There are courses where it makes sense to offer some credits over and above the full-time equivalent because it suits employers better or better prepares the students. The issue is that we need to control the amount of that, so we do require that there are limits on it and that it's previously, you know, it's agreed with the funding council. So that it's not uncontrolled. So, but there are circumstances in which additionality is perfectly acceptable and is a good thing.
Sorry, I probably misphrased. Okay, I mean, we're talking here around the change in guidelines, aren't we, from the SFC, and that change wasn't properly implemented. So that change, Mr. Williamson, were you aware of it?
I was aware of the change in the policy, but there was ongoing dialogue between the curriculum VPs and the funding council on a regular basis.
Mm-hmm. So my understanding is that the college continued to overclaim. Is that correct?
Well,
that's correct. So why was that, Mr. Williamson?
Why was it? Well, there was a belief in the college, from my perspective, there was a belief that what had been agreed with the funding council was being represented through the reports that were being received on the actual weighted sums figures.
I'm sorry, I don't understand that. You'll have to tell me that in layman's terms.
Okay. If there is additionality above the agreed additionality level, then the courses within the frameworks really have to be changed. To bring that down the weighted sums attached to these courses, and then that brings it down to the level they ought to have been. So therefore, the teaching of that we wouldn't attract credits for. Within the reports, when we receive the reports give the up-to-date position. So there was a view that the up-to-date position included the changes in additionality.
But you knew about the change in guidelines?
Oh, I knew there was a change in the guidelines.
Okay, so why did the college continue to overclaim if you were Director of Finance at the time?
Because it's the curriculum responsible for the implementation of that guideline.
So it wasn't your fault?
Well, I rely upon the information that I receive through the reporting. And
received from whom?
Pardon?
Received from whom?
Well, from the system. It's system-generated reports.
The system in the college,
yes,
which presumably people populate.
That's right, yeah.
Okay, so you're saying to me that you received false information from colleagues that then led you to overclaim on behalf of the college?
Well, I don't know if it was false information, but I was taking the information as read, and therefore I was basing any of my financial projections on the numbers that they were coming off.
So did you knew the new guidance from the SFC. Did you think to check it at all, to check that this information you were receiving was correct?
Well, the responsibility for that lay with on the curriculum side, and they were having the dialogue with the funding council. So I was of the belief that what was being agreed on additionality was being changed in the system, and therefore the reports I was receiving were giving me the accurate picture.
Okay. So what you're saying to me is there was a misunderstanding among some staff in the college that were providing you with this information about the new guidelines?
I believe.
Okay.
Yeah.
And were those members of your team or other senior managers?
I think it was a mixture of both. I think it was within the team and senior managers.
Okay. How come this has been such a problem at Edinburgh College and maybe not at other colleges, Dr. Kemp?
It's something we're actively engaging with quite a lot of colleges on, and the reason is it's not that there's been substantial change of policy on it. There's always been rules on related, what used to be called related study. The difference is that with the new simplified funding method, and I'm sorry if this sounds really boring and technical, but there used to be a thing called the full-time tariff with a number of sums that went into a full-time place. If you did a particular number, you were paid for a slightly different number. So it was, there was less of a clarity between the number of sums a college did and what they were paid for. With the removal of that full-time tariff, it becomes, you know, more financially advantageous for a college to do additionality. So we need to be quite clear about when it is genuinely good use of public money for that additional course to be done. So we changed the rules a couple of years ago. We clarified them in the context of the new funding system a couple of years ago. So we've been engaging with quite a few colleges to understand why they have a particular level of additionality and whether that's appropriate. And sometimes that leads to the amount going down. Sometimes it doesn't because we're quite happy. So this has been something we've been doing across the sector.
Are you satisfied that the Scottish Funding Council did enough to appraise and educate staff at Edinburgh College as to the new guidelines?
Yes, and in the case of Edinburgh College, and that's, you know, one of the reasons we did apply a clawback, but then, you know, we used it to help the business transformation plan, was it was a college we had engaged very heavily with through the outcome manager, with senior managers on this issue. And so that's, yes, I'm absolutely satisfied.
I understand there was even a workshop held, is that correct?
Yes, I mean, the outcome manager engaged several times with the college and several people in the college on it.
Okay, so Mr. Williamson, if the Scottish Funding Council went to such lengths with their outcome manager holding a workshop, why were so many staff still providing you with wrong information that allowed you to overclaim?
Well, I'm not so sure that all members of staff have been provided with wrong information.
Sorry, I can't hear you.
I'm not certain about the wrong information. The information, there was a belief that the information that was being agreed on additionality had worked its way through into the system, the reporting system. And therefore, we were using the reports that came off. I can't comment on who attended the Funding Council events. I don't know who attended them.
Mr. Williamson, were there any concerns raised by any of your senior colleagues or members of your team as to what was going on in terms of claims?
All that I know is there was dialogue with the Funding Council on additionality.
Any concerns raised to you personally?
There weren't any concerns raised to me, and hence why I was saying that I was using the reports that were coming off. There was no other concerns raised.
So you weren't concerned at all, having read the... Did you attend one of these SFC workshops?
Don't think so, no.
Okay, but you knew the guidelines?
I was aware of the guidelines.
Okay, and you weren't concerned about the information you were receiving and that and the sums that was then... leading you to claim?
No. I place reliance on my colleagues as well, that if they're working with the Funding Council and they're interpreting the guidelines, then whatever changes are in the course frameworks that are required, then these would be followed through.
As Director of Finance, is it not your job, being in control of, well, being appraised of the guidance, to be double-checking back with colleagues to check that the information you're getting is correct before you submit the claims?
Well, I'm responsible for the finance, estates, HR, IT, so I have that amount of responsibility. The reliance on the data, then I place reliance on my colleagues to ensure that whatever's been interpreted through the guidelines and whatever has been agreed with the Funding Council actually works its way into the reports.
With respect, Mr. Williamson, I would expect a Director of Finance, an institution the size of Edinburgh College, commanding such a salary as you do, to perhaps being aware that there'd been a guideline change, to maybe ask questions of colleagues providing you with this information, knowing that you were responsible for this, for the claims of this additional money.
Well, I'm not responsible for the claims. It's coming through in the funding through the activity that we produce.
Responsible. You were Director of Finance.
Yeah, but the two VPs we're responsible for the implementation of the guidance on additionality. If they had raised a concern to say that they were overclaiming on additionality, then I would have been liaising with the Funding Council as well to establish the extent of any clawback.
Vice Principal, that's only part of their job. Vice Principals perform a number of functions in colleges. Your role was as Director of Finance. It's your job to keep the finances in order. Should you not have not been raising questions with them rather than them raising questions with you?
I think given the outcome, with hindsight, perhaps I should have been questioning more. Yeah.
Okay. So you feel that looking back, you should have questioned more the data you were receiving before putting the claims into the SFC?
Well, I think given the outcome, with hindsight, I should have done, yeah.
Okay. But Mr. Williamson, I mean, you've since been promoted, haven't you?
No.
No. I understand your title's now Chief Operating Officer.
The title's changed, but I've not been promoted.
So what would you put, I mean, this has been a financial mess. I can't think of any other way of describing it at Edinburgh College. What would you put that down to?
Since merger, Edinburgh College has had quite a lot of difficulty achieving its income targets. And that's probably been compounded by the austerity measures as well. But following the austerity measures, we've also had real difficulty with commercial and international and tuition fees. And a supplementary aspect that when you're not achieving credits, particularly on the HE side, you also don't attract the SAS fee on top. So it's predominantly been the income side where we've had a lot of the big challenges.
Mr. Williamson, you said looking back that you probably should have been questioning colleagues more on the information they were giving you regarding additionality. Do you take some personal responsibility for this situation that has emerged at Edinburgh College?
Not to do with additionality.
Do you take personal responsibility for it to do with something else?
No.
But you said that you should have asked questions of colleagues.
What I said was, with hindsight, I perhaps should have asked.
So does that suggest that you should have taken, that you are taking some personal responsibility for not asking those questions?
Well, had the additionality come in and we were fine with additionality, then I would have been using the same types of reports and I would have been using the same numbers. Because the additionality wasn't completed in accordance with the agreed figures, then perhaps, with hindsight, I maybe should have been asking more.
Okay.
But then we weren't working on the basis that we weren't going to achieve the additionality figure that was agreed.
Okay. And you can confirm to me today that no colleagues, either in your team or senior colleagues, raised concerns with you about this at all?
No, nobody raised concerns.
Okay. Seems quite an unsatisfactory situation, but unless members have any other questions, Colin Beattie.
Thank you very much. Just got one other question. We've heard nothing from Mr. Harvey, and I wonder if he might want to make a comment about the efficiency and the results that came from internal audit.
In terms of my role and giving my opinion on the financial statements, I would look to both the confirmations that come from the Funding Council and the work that had been done by Internal Audit in providing me with the evidence around the additionality and indeed all the other credits that are claimed. As you had actually pointed out yourself, in terms of the sequence of events, I wasn't aware of there being an issue until October. When Mr. Williamson had made me aware of it, and
October 2015.
October 2015, when I was looking at the July 15 results, and I understood at that stage he also told Mr. Brown about the potential issue from.
So that's when the SFC came back.
That's correct.
And told the college there was a problem.
Yes, that's
when you became aware.
That's the first time I was made aware of it. Yes. And at that stage, the focus of my work was then to understand what the Funding Council's position would be in relation to that clawback so that I could ensure that it was then correctly reflected in the accounts.
Now, Mr. Brown's already said that he was aware of this problem some time before.
Mm-hmm.
Would you expect to be alerted to that at any point?
I was surprised that people were aware of it in advance and I wasn't made aware. As I said, I wait until I've got the best available evidence in order to form my opinion, and that would be confirmations from the Funding Council. So I wouldn't necessarily expect to be told about it in advance of those confirmations. However, as I did say, there was some surprise when I heard that today.
Okay, thank you.
Final question. Ms. Bruton, at what point did you become aware that Mr. Williamson was in receipt of money that the college was not entitled to claim?
Well, we aren't in receipt of it because we claim it as we go through the year. There were two elements to this. One, I could see when I came into post that there was something wrong with student recruitment, and I was aware that from the Funding Council that we needed to drive down the amount of additionality we were claiming. And so within weeks of being in post, I asked for a review of the curriculum frameworks, which was undertaken by the senior curriculum staff. Then when it got to the point of phase four, so we'd reduced the amount of claim that we made at that point in time, and I went to the Funding Council to ask them to reduce our overall targets. Then when we were coming up to the fourth quarter of the year, the phase four report, I asked further questions about whether it was the case that we'd driven out all the additionality that we needed to do, and sought further assurance on that. And I asked for that to be done again, and I asked a member of staff from outside the executive team whose own department was quite expert in doing this work on additionality to take another look at it with the management information team. And they uncovered at that point in time that there was still additionality that was over and above what we had agreed for that year. And we spoke to the Funding Council about that again. And so the figures that went in finally, we were uncovering those facts as the final figures were going in. I'm not sure if I answered your question, Convener.
I think you have. Okay. Yeah. We're going to draw to a close. Can I thank the panel of witnesses very much indeed for your evidence this morning. I'm going to suspend now for 2 minutes while we move into private session. Thank you.